I've chosen this subject because I thought that it is important in today's world that one has an understanding of what is news, what is communication, and more specifically, what is the post-truth era. Now this word I heard for the first time in 2016 elections, not elections, 2016. I think it was nominated as the word of the year by the Oxford University. And it was also the year President Trump won his elections. And it was also the year when I think the Britain or the United Kingdom decided to exit the European Union. Now both these campaigns were very highly polarized campaigns. And I do not know who actually invented this word, but I always had this sense, I don't know how many of you have read this George Orwell book, 1984. So there is a Ministry of Truth in that book. So Ministry of Truth, the work of that ministry is basically to create a uniformity, you know. Everything falls in line, everything falls in narrative. So if there is something happening which is not part of that narrative and there are, you know, some jigsaws and some puzzles here and there, so there have to be a linearity in that. As it is defined, the post-truth era, and if 2016 is 00 AD or BC of the communication as far as post-truth era, one may call this entire phenomena where especially in political communications and discourse, rather than objectivity and facts, it is the appeal to the innate biases and the emotions of the people that is addressed, rather than facts, figures, and other things. Why this is happening now? Why did not happen earlier? Now, these are the questions which we would want to probably investigate or try to look at during this talk. I think there are two basic things why this is happening. First of all, there has been a disruption in the way we are communicating now. And second thing is the modes of communications are also changing concurrently. Now, if you look at it initially, once the language was invented, how it was invented, there are two obviously forms of it. One is the oral language, the other is a written language. Every era in the human history is associated with a certain technology which is used, which has been used to communicate from interpersonal communications and later proceeding towards mass communication. So initially, you know, if you have plaques put up at places to communicate, 1400, I think you had the first printing press, which started the first mass communication exercise in the sense that books were printed. Then you had the radio, which was once again used as a mode of mass communication, and then you had the satellite television. Now with each passing generation, you see that the new technology comes as a disruptor. But most of these things that we are seeing are linear in nature. The other aspect of this form of communication has been that it forms a very traditional form of communication wherein one-to-many communication, that is one person communicates to many people in this slide. So for example, if you run a radio channel, you are one person, you're reading out the news, you're communicating to many people. You have a satellite television station, you're communicating to the masses. The entry barrier is very, very high. So I cannot decide to set up a television channel today and start mass communicating, or a radio station today, start mass communication. The advent of the internet has brought down this bar. The entry level has been brought down. So everybody is a disruptor now. Everybody can intervene. So if you have a news organization or a print organization, say a penny press in 1930s, wherein you have a news organization, a print organization, there is an editorial setup which is going to sift the news, balance the news, this is right, this is wrong, fact check at every level. You have an environment wherein everybody can intervene, everybody is a journalist. There are two sides to it. You know, one is obviously the positive side, but we have seen that this democratization of communication has led to some very great experiments in the world. Tahrir Square, if you remember, in Egypt, you know, it all started by people who started participating in a protest in a country where, say like Egypt, or there have been protests in Iran to a greater extent where people have used the internet to participate in those protests. But then at the same point in time, we've also used, we have had the other aspect or the other side of it, the flip side of it, wherein this low entry barrier has been used for a specific purpose. In the post-truth era, in a phenomena which is increasingly worrying people, what is called the fake news, in the creation of news, which is, if I were to define it, and one of my professors used to define it, that it is information which is could be misinformation, but used for a strategic purpose towards a certain end. You know, how you display it, how you project it before people, that is something which is being used increasingly. Why and how it is being used is, I think, this the second chart, I think it displays it. Because when we have a one-on-one communication or one-to-many communication, then there is a certain amount of, you know, checks and balances operating. But in this media environment, if you look at it, this is a hybrid media environment wherein everybody could participate. So for example, there is a piece of information which is created or generated in a newspaper, a single column story. It's a single column story, may have appeared in a Eveninger or a daily which is not a very reputed daily. Now a screenshot or a picture of that is tweeted by somebody in the social media. That social media or a tweet is taken up by some other person, it spreads. That tweet is probably embedded by somebody who's using the WhatsApp and spread further. There is a politician who thinks that probably his communication or his constituency is best served if he uses that piece of information, and it helps him to emotionally connect to a certain bias of the constituency that he's referring to. Why I'm using this particular word bias is that, you know, we have a sociological inherent tendency to believe in or what we already believe in. You know, we believe our biases. So if you get a message that I tend to like X person, and if I get a message that, you know, X person is done right, then I have an innate, you know, habit to believe and also spread it and pass it on to the others. So then this politician picks that information up, gives it to somebody else, or uses it in their own way. So by the time you realize or somebody fact checks, it has spread all across. There's no way actually you can, there's a rebuttal. Traditionally, how would it had happened? Suppose if there is a wrong piece of information in a newspaper or column, somebody would have sent a rejoinder or a rebuttal. The newspaper would have been forced to print that rebuttal or a rejoinder. If not, then that person or the reporter or a newspaper or a television organization could have been taken to courts for defamation or anything else. We do not know where this has originated from. And anybody can intervene. It can disrupt the communication. So we have had, you know, instances, and it is being investigated in the USA, that a factory of or a BPO working in some remote part in Russia is influencing elections in the USA. 2 days back, there was a story in a newspaper, I think AFP carried a story, that the Oxford Internet Organization is saying that probably Russia is going to influence the Indian elections the next time around in 2019. The way you do it, I mean, it was unheard of, it could be unthinkable, say 10 years back, that this could have happened. But then, increasingly, as we operate in the World Wide Web, it's a chamber, it's an ego chamber. The person who creates most noise, the louder noise, you won't tend to hear that noise. And there is no way to verify whether it is right or wrong, correct or incorrect. Which is why a few points I would like to mention here, how to, you know, to see that a particular piece of information is correct or not correct. I think objectivity is the prime thing, is a very, very important thing. Objectivity in one's own life. You know, you need to question whether what one is seeing, what is forwarding is right or wrong, it is plausible, not plausible. And there are various, you know, very simple ways of doing that. You check the URLs also. Media organizations who have reputations, who are seen to give correct information, have a certain URL. You can identify with them, cross-check those. Read before sharing. We have a certain tendency also that, you know, we share information or something on the internet just because we want to look smart. We don't even read it. You know, there is a Guardian piece which comes to us, and if we forward it, say, oh, it's a Guardian piece. If I send it to my friends, they'll think that I'm smart and I'm reading Guardian piece. That's a huge problem that one is facing. And it's quite prevalent. And there has been some concrete empirical research to show that this has been one of the major problems as far as the dissemination of fake news is concerned. Then the source checking. And there's another very worrying phenomenon which has propped up recently called the deep fake. I'm not sure that whether you're aware of that. People have actually invented softwares where you can be seen on the screen to be saying something which you have actually not said. So there was a video of Barack Obama a few days, months back, where he was seen to be saying something on a particular issue which he never said. It was created by softwares. There was an instance recently when there was a CEO who had a conversation with journalists, and it was off the record conversation. He was saying something, and there was a deepfake created, and the next day, the stock prices of that particular company plummeted because of that one piece of information which went viral. So it could be that dangerous. Lastly, a few things about data, privacy, and democracy. Why I'm talking about is that there's very little understanding of why data is important and why privacy is important, data privacy is important in this country. In foreign countries, there are very specific rules about it. You cannot, nobody can share your data. In India, people do not actually, you know, think much about sharing one's data. To put it in very crude way, you know, to explain it to you guys, although that's probably not the best of the examples, that if your data is available, your biometric data is available, your fingerprints are available, they can be planted just about anywhere, and you can be implicated also. I mean, it's a very crude way of saying it, but then that's, I think, how a lot of people, you know, I try to explain it, how data dissemination and privacy is important. Data mining and its use in this entire exercise. Data mining is basically collecting of massive data and using it for communication purposes for a specific intent. For example, if I have the data regarding your name, your telephone number of each and every person in this room, and if I were contesting an election, and I know that X, Y, or Z would vote for me if I promise X, Y, Z something particular to them, and I have that data, then I can have an interpersonal communication with you. You know, and that's unto itself a distortion. Because if I proclaim something, you know, openly, if I say, suppose that I am going to build 1,000 toilets in this country or in this constituency, if I don't build it, then I am in a democracy held accountable for not having done that. Now, if I suppose send you a personal communication in your mobile and say that I'm going to build a toilet for you, you know, there is no public proclamation and there is no public accountability for that. This micro-messaging is something which a lot of academics, both in democracy and political science, are talking about how it can be misused and whether it's good for democracy or bad for democracy. Obviously, there are ways of data mining which are good for, you know, various other purposes. That was the last point, you know, I wanted to make. But lastly, the only thing I would like to emphasize once again is that bring in an objectivity. You know, as a journalist, I was always told, I've been a physics student, and as a science student, whatever I learned, that be logical. Question, question, question. And whenever you're fed a piece of information, at least question, try to find out whether it can be right or wrong, plausible, implausible, whether it is possible. And that probably is the only way to get out of this entire cycle. I'm sure there are people, I mean, I read, keep on reading it every day, that, you know, it's a very vicious circle, and it would be very difficult to get over this. The credibility of the media organizations is down. But I think we have seen in the past also, systems have evolved and they have been able to come trumps over such issues. For example, we have seen that societies where media unto itself has high credibility, the problem of fake news has been considerably less. For example, if Emmanuel Macron is elected the French president, so you never get to hear that Facebook was manipulated or Twitter was manipulated. And why is it that, you know, you when you hear about the American elections, that you hear that you have very polarized society, very polarized debate, and then you get to hear these stories and the investigations are going on. To a great extent, I believe that the media, that legacy or the conventional and the traditional media has a lot of responsibility in this regard. The more objective they are, the more credible they are, I think the lesser people are going to believe in fake news, and I think they would be able to trust these legacy media organizations to actually fall prey to disinformation. Thank you.